Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, whatever time you're watching this. Welcome to my office, once again, our chapel. Today, we will have the Liturgy of the Word for the 10th Sunday after Pentecost. Year's just moving right along. As usual, if you have a Book of Common Prayer, I will give out page numbers for you. And if you're on the email list at the church, you may have received the order of service, which will have everything on either a Word document or a PDF. And our opening hymn is When Morning Gilds the Sky, number 427 in the 1982 hymnal. When morning gilds the skies, my heart awaking cries, may Jesus Christ be praised, alike at work and prayer, to Jesus I begin on page 355 in the Book of Common Prayer. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and blessed be God's kingdom now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The setting for the Gloria is number S280 in the hymnal. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High. Jesus Christ with the Holy Spirit. In the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Grant to us, Lord, we pray, the Spirit to think and do always those things that are right, that we, who cannot exist without you, may by you be enabled to live according to your will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. So, our first lesson this morning is from the first book of Kings, chapter 19, verses 9 to 18. A reading from the first book of Kings. At that place he came to a cave and spent the night there. Then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He answered, "I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with a sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away." He said, "Go out and stand on the mountain before the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by." Now there was a great wind, so strong that it was splitting mountains and breaking rocks in pieces before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a sound of sheer silence. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. Then there came a voice to him that said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He answered, "I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away." Then the Lord said to him, "Go. Return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus. When you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael as king over Aram. You shall also anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, as king over Israel. And you shall anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat, of Abel-Meholah, as prophet in your place. Whoever escapes from the sword of Hazael, Jehu shall kill. And whoever escapes from the sword of Jehu, Elisha shall kill. Yet I will leave 7,000 in Israel, all the knees that have not bowed down to Baal, and every mouth that has not kissed him." Here ends the reading. Our psalm this morning, or afternoon or evening, depending when you're doing this, our psalm is Psalm 85, verses 8 to 13. And it may be found on page 709 of the Book of Common Prayer. Let us say it together. I will listen to what the Lord God is saying, for he is speaking peace to his faithful people and to those who turn their hearts to him. Truly his salvation is very near to those who fear him, that his glory may dwell in our land. Mercy and truth have met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. Truth shall spring up from the earth, and righteousness shall look down from heaven. The Lord will indeed grant prosperity, and our land will yield its increase. Righteousness shall go before him, and peace shall be a pathway for his feet. Our second reading is Romans chapter 10, verses 5 to 15. A reading from Paul's letter to the Christians in Rome. Moses writes concerning the righteousness that comes from the law, that the person who does these things will live by them. But the righteousness that comes from faith says, do not say in your heart who will ascend into heaven, that is, to bring Christ down, or who will descend into the abyss, that is, to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you, on your lips and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart and so is justified, and one confesses with the mouth and so is saved. The scripture says, no one who believes in him will be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all and is generous to all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. But how are they to call on one in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in one of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone to proclaim him? And how are they to proclaim him unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. The word of the Lord. Our song before the gospel is Precious Lord, Take My Hand, which is number 106 in Leave Us, Lift Every Voice and Sing. Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, help me stand. Our gospel today is Matthew chapter 14, verses 22 to 33. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew. Immediately he made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead to the other side, while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But by this time the boat, battered by the waves, was far from the land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning he came walking toward them on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It is a ghost!" And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid." Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat, started walking on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he noticed a strong wind, he became frightened, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "You have little faith, why did you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind ceased. And those in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." The Gospel of the Lord. Well, I'm an extrovert. I enjoy being around people, and I get energized around people. Other people are introverts. They need time alone, away from others, in order to gain energy. Nowadays, with the lockdown and all, many or most of us are spending time alone. In our story from the first book of Kings and our gospel passage, we hear about two people who needed some time alone. In the story from the first book of Kings, the prophet Elijah came to Mount Horeb, the mountain of God. He found a cave and he decided to spend the night there. Elijah was there because he had upset King Ahab and his wife Jezebel. He won a contest against the 450 prophets of Baal and the 400 prophets of Asherah, and had proved that the God of Israel was the strongest God. You probably remember this story from Sunday school. Well, the people who witnessed the contest fell on their knees and said, "The God of Elijah is the only God." King Ahab and Jezebel worshipped Baal and Asherah, and so Elijah had to get out of town. When he found a cave in Mount Horeb, he spent the night there. God came to him and spoke to him. God asked Elijah why he was there, and Elijah answered that the Israelites wanted to kill him. God told Elijah to go outside and wait for God. Elijah stood outside, and there was a great wind, a wind so strong it was breaking rocks and splitting the mountains. But God was not in the wind. After the great wind, there was a strong earthquake which shook everything, but God was not in the earthquake. The earthquake was followed by a fire, but God was not in the fire either. Then there was the sound of sheer silence. And then God spoke to Elijah. God sent Elijah back to Israel and gave him instructions to anoint new leaders and to make Elisha, the prophet, in his place. Elijah was alone with God, but now God was sending him back to do God's will and to prepare for the end of his ministry. Another person who needed to spend some time alone was Jesus, but he was rarely allowed to do so. When Jesus had learned about the execution of John the Baptist, he and the disciples decided to go away to a quiet place to mourn. We talked about this last Sunday. Everyone followed them to the other side of the lake, and after healing the many who needed his touch, Jesus ended up feeding over 5,000 people. And our story today picks up after the meal, when Jesus sent the disciples across the lake while he went up the hill to spend some time alone with God in prayer. As the disciples were rowing across the lake, the wind became stronger and stronger, and they were getting worried. Then they saw a figure in the distance, and as it came closer, they noticed somebody walking on the surface of the lake. they became frightened because they thought it was a ghost. Jesus called out to them and said, "Take heart, do not be afraid." Peter wasn't sure it was Jesus, so he decided to test him, and he said, "If it's really you, call to me and have me walk on the water." So Jesus said, "Come." Peter got out of the boat, started walking on the surface of the water, but then became frightened by the wind and waves and lost his focus, and he started to sink and cry out, "Lord, save me." And Jesus heard him and reached out his hand and grabbed Peter before he sank beneath the waves. And Jesus said, "Oh, man of little faith, why did you doubt?" I don't know if Peter's main problem was doubt, but I know he lost focus. Instead of concentrating on Jesus and Jesus' call to him, he started noticing the wind and the waves, and he began to panic. Losing our focus is a common problem. It's something we all do. And we know what God wants us to do, and we may start to do it, but then we lose our focus, and we start to worry about what others might think, or worry about whether we're being taken advantage of. And when we become worried, we call out, "Lord, save us." And Jesus always saves us. Now, I'm proud of our church because even though we are in the midst of a pandemic, we continue to distribute food to those in need. People who can't feed their family are in distress. When we're in distress, we call to God to help us. When others are in distress, I believe God is asking us to help them. We're following Jesus' commandments by helping those in distress. Instead of being like Peter and losing our focus so that we sink beneath the waves, we should always answer yes to God's call and be the means by which God works. We can keep our focus on Jesus and do what Jesus would do for others. As I said last week, what strikes me when I read these stories is the selflessness of Jesus. He is always willing to forego his own needs to help others. And I think that Jesus calls us to do the same at times. God is a gracious God and merciful and compassionate, and I believe God wants us to be the same. Jesus was always selfless and merciful to all he encountered. Our God is a loving and compassionate God, and we, as those who love God, can be as loving and compassionate to others. Amen. Well, our service continues as we say together the Nicene Creed found on page 358 in the Book of Common Prayer. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We continue to pray for those who have the coronavirus and those who have died due to complications from COVID-19. We pray for all of us in our homes and for those who must leave their homes to work. We pray for those around the world who are sick and frightened. We pray for those who are unable to work as their jobs have been suspended or ended. We pray for those who are worried about food and paying the rent or mortgage. We pray that everyone will be relieved of their anxieties and worries. We pray for those who are fighting for an end to racism and injustice, and we pray for peace in the streets of our nation. And we pray that the leaders of the nations will recognize the dignity of every human being. Today, we'll also remember a couple of those who are no longer with us, especially John and Clara Radin, who were longtime members of this church. Today, August 9th, would have been their wedding anniversary. And yesterday, August 8th, would have been Clara's birthday. Yesterday, August 8th, was also my mother's birthday. She passed away last year, so she's celebrating in heaven. May their souls and the souls of all the faithful departed rest in peace, and may light perpetual shine upon them. Our prayers of the people are in a time of virus, fear, and economic collapse. Almighty God, we pray for those who have died of the coronavirus, for those who are sick, and for those who are afraid of getting sick. Be the shepherd of your people, O Lord, we pray. In the midst of such uncertainty, we wonder how to keep ourselves, our families, our companies, and our churches afloat in a time of economic meltdown. We ask you to protect us all. We pray for the millions who are laid off from work and for those who must continue to work because they provide essential services or cannot otherwise feed their children. Give us today our daily bread. We pray for the first responders, doctors, nurses, and all who work in healthcare. We pray for all who are confined to hospitals, nursing homes, and institutions, and for family members who are not allowed to visit. We pray for those who are responsible for public health decisions, that they will be guided by science and duty, not ideology or politics. You are the greatest healer, Lord. Lord, have mercy on our public officials. Guide them to create appropriate policies. Give them wisdom and good judgment. Help them put humanity first, that the people may follow their guidelines and take into account the safety of everyone in all we do. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. Lord, help us guide our children and our parents through this emergency with cheerfulness, optimism, and faith. Help us to lay aside our fears and to focus on the needs of others. Where we can be helpful, let us act on their behalf, even if only from a distance. Lord, make us instruments of your peace. We turn to you, O Lord, for we have no other help, and we know you are sufficient. You are the very power of love, of health, and of healing, of protection and mercy. Come then, Lord, and help your people, bought with the price of your own blood, and bring us with your saints to glory everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. As I've said before, if you're watching this on our website, please consider using the donate button. PayPal's an easy way to donate. That's our digital offering plate. And if you're watching this directly on YouTube, or if you're on the All Saints Cristo Rey Facebook page, please go to our website, and the URL is on the YouTube description, but it's asecw.blogspot.com. And our closing hymn is Love Divine, All Loves Excelling, number 657 in the 1982 hymnal. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the love and knowledge of God and of God's Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen. Have a good week. Stay safe. Keep washing your hands, wearing your mask, and if you can, stay home. And we'll see you next week, the Lord willing, and the creeks don't rise.